Welcome to the sixth episode of Programming with Qt Widgets. In today's episode, we'll talk about signals and slots, or how objects communicate. A common problem you often face when you're developing applications is, how do two objects communicate? How does one object tell its surrounding about state changes? We've seen lots of design patterns trying to solve that problem. The observer pattern is likely the most well-known one, where you subclass in different ways to allow observers to be notified about changes in your class. Qt has its own mechanism for this, and it's called signals and slots. Before we dive into how it works in Qt, let's just review what has been tried over the years. And one is indeed observer patterns, which is what they did in Java. And you have a number of interfaces, and you register your listener with those interfaces, and it often results in many classes, many small classes for handling all the different things that happened. Then we have the mutif way, where you're registering function pointers. But what happens if the parameters doesn't match? Well, we all end up with a graceful or not so graceful death. Qt uses signals and slot on the semantics level. That is the level of what the object's intention was. The intention of a push button is to be clicked, so there's a signal for that. The intention for a line is for text to be typed, so there's a signal for that. The intention for a list view is for its item be selected, so there are signals for that. And then on the syntactic level, listening to the individual bits that makes up the larger actions, like the mouse being moved around or the mouse being clicked on something that isn't a push button or whatever, those things are virtual methods that are being overwritten. We'll see that a bit later, but let's start out talking about signals and slots. As a software developer, you just love reinventing the wheel, right? Well, neither do we. Therefore, we created a toolbox that we call KD Toolbox. In KD Toolbox, you'll find lots of useful things for Qt developers. And let me just give you three highlights from it. There's include mocks, which will help you speed up your Qt application. There is a lot of model view framework stuff. We'll talk much more about model view later in this series. And then there is signal slot throttlers, and you just learned about signal slot. This will allow you something that emits a lot of signals that will just come in to be just one signal being emitted. Back to black and white, Jesper. What you're looking at here are two widgets from the Qt toolbox. On one side, we have a slider, and the other side, we have a spin box. They might not look exactly like this on your system. That depends on the style used on your system. What I would like now is for the slider to tell the spin box whenever its value has changed. And we do this using a signal slot connection. And as part of the signal slot connection, the slider emits a signal. So it will basically tell the world about its internal state change that it thinks is important for the world. So it goes something like this. My value has changed to 42. It will shout out. There might be nobody listening. There might be 100 interested parties. It doesn't care. It just scream it out. On the receiving side, the spin box needs to implement a slot. And how does that work? Well, I'll get back to that in a few videos from here, how you actually implement your own signals and slot. But for now, just accept that there needs to be a slot on the Qt spin box. For the two to communicate together, I need a signal slot connection. You can think of a signal slot connection as a tube that goes between the output of the slider and the input of the spin box, and whatever is put in on one side will come out immediately on the other side. In code, it looks like this, and it's one of four different three different ways of connecting signals and slots, and it's what's known as the Qt 5 or the modern way of doing it. It was introduced in Qt 5, this pointer to member functions. But Basically, what you need to do when you connect your signals and slots are to think of these four fingers. First, who is emitting the signal? In our case, it's the slider. Which signal are we talking about? A given widget can emit multiple different signals. So we need to specify that it's a value change signal that we're talking about. Then third, I can't do that. Here we are. Third, which object is implementing, and not what type of object, but which object exactly is this particular spin box that I have a pointer to that is called spin box. And fourth, and one I can do, namely, which slot are we talking about? And just like this slider could have multiple different signals, the spin box obviously has lots of different slots too. And in general, any Q objects can have a number of different slots, and that's what you specify with the fourth parameter, which of those slot are we interested in. Now you might also ask, how are signals actually being emitted, and what does a slot look like? How do I implement a slot? And we'll see that in much more details once we get to talk about how do you implement your own signals and slot shortly. But I know that you cannot wait, so let me just continue my animation over here. You emit a signal by declaring your signal in your header file. So in QSlider, there is a QSlider.h that says that it has a value changed that brings out an integer. And then whenever I want to emit it, I will write something like emit the name of the signal here, value changed, and the actual new value to be emitted. And for the implementation side of it, for the slot, it's basically just a regular C++ method that I implement here. And if I need to do it with a Qt4 way of signal slot connection, I need a bit of extra syntactic sugar. We'll see that a bit later. Otherwise, the slot is just a regular C++ method. Now, there are at least three different ways that you can connect your signals and slots. And the first way we already seen, that's the pointer to member function. That's these four fingers. And that was introduced with Qt5. And as we'll see shortly, it's changed the way we understand the world almost. Okay, that's an exaggeration, but nevertheless, it was super cool. In Qt4, we had a different mechanism, also the four fingers, but there was a few macros involved, and I'll show you what it looks like. Not that I expected you're going to write that code ever, but I'm sure that when you Google or you ask ChatGPT, it will tell you something about this, and then it's useful to know what it looked like back then. And the third way of doing it is using a function object, basically a callable, and the most well-known of those are lambda expressions. Let's start with the first two in this episode here. And in the next episode, I'll show you how you connect to a lambda expression, because that goes with a bit of discussion on when is that a good idea. So the number of times you do it is 80%. You'll do the Qt5 version, the one that I'm showing you now. 0% you'll do the Qt4, and 20% you'll do it with lambda. So let's just start with the 80%. It's always good to see the most common one. And if you look at the documentation, you'll see that it connects here. One Q object pointer sender, another Q object pointer receiver here, and then for the signal and the slot, the pointer to member function. And a pointer to member function, that's this syntax that you have down here. You have an address of an object, :, a method in that object. And let me just show you this example running here. Sure, you do not believe me, but here is the slider. It looks slightly different than what the screenshot showed me, but you can see when I'm moving it around, it does something. And just move it over here and look at the source code real quick. There isn't much new in here, but then again, we haven't seen all that much source code in this training so far. We have a Q application here. We remember that from the very first time. I'm creating a Q widget being the topmost one here. I'm saying set attribute, WA delete on close, which means that whenever I close that window, it will be deleted by the system itself. I'm creating a layout manager. Remember, we saw that in the previous episode. I'm setting up a slider here. I'm setting the range of the slider to go from 0 to 100. I'm creating a spin box. I'm saying that this spin box should be read-only. I cannot change it. Nope. I am trying desperately, but it is indeed read-only. I am setting up a horizontal layout manager here between the two, and then I am adding that layout manager to my layout manager, top layout, to my top layout. So why do I even need a top layout? I think this example was cut out from something bigger, because there is no use for a top layout manager, but hey, that's cool. And finally, here is my connection. Connect the slider's value chain to the spin box set value, and I set the value of the slider to be 40. This leads to a number of questions, at least. First, will the set value actually make the slider emit its signal? More general, when I call set something, will that make an object emits its signals? That entirely depends on the signal. If we go and have a look, let's just go and look at the, if I can find a slider, here's the slider, look at the documentation for QSlider. You can see scrolling down, there is no signal section. Of course, there's not, because this QSlider is a subclass of QAbstractSlider. And QAbstractSlider is the one that has the number of signals. So there's one here called value changed. That one, obviously, as we saw, that one is emitted whenever I call set value. But if I had listened to slider moved, then I'm sure it would not, because that is a signal about when the user is moving the slider around. So it basically depends. The other question, I can find my application area. Had this not been read-only, would I have been able to see the value change over here? You can pause the video now when you think about it. That's good. So your answer was set read-only false. Let's try. Your answer was hopefully no, it will not, because the signal, I'm saying this particular signal should go into this particular slot over there. So of course, if I'm changing the value here, my slider is not moving at all. But if I'm changing the value here, this one is updated. Now comes the good question. Can I make that work? Could I do something like connecting the value change of the spin box to the set value of the slider? And yes, I can do that. And we'll see that, I hope, in a few seconds, because it leads me to another problem that I have with signal slot, namely overloaded. Is it signal for slot? I cannot remember. But wouldn't it go like this? My value has changed to 42. Awesome. My value changed to 42. Better take notice. Oh, my value changed. My value has changed to 2. So my value has changed to 42. So the slider would be telling the spin box, which would be telling the slider, which would be telling the spin box. And yes, it would go exactly like this had it not been for one small test inside of both QSlider and QSpinbox, where they test whether the value they are about to say was a new value was actually new. And for your code, whenever you emit signal, take care of actually validating that you have a new value before you say, hey, my value has changed to this. If it's the same as it was before, you can break the loop of such situations by not re-emitting the signal. Time flies when you're in good company, they say. I'm sitting here all by myself looking into a camera, so I am surely in good company. Today's episode, I have planned for you to also see the Qt 4 way of signal slot connections, but I'll do that in the next video. So if you are watching this almost live, then it's going to be tomorrow that you'll be seeing it. Otherwise, well, head over to the next video right away to see Qt 4 signal slot connections. Until then, I'm Jesper Pedersen from KDAB, and I've been enjoying your company so far. I hope you enjoyed mine too. Have a great time.